Bill, who is Revlon's next guest?
Well, Hal, our next guest on the golden threshold of the $64,000 question is from Thule, Greenland, Peter Freuchen.
Good evening, Peter. Good
evening.
Welcome back to the show.
Good evening.
You're looking very chipper tonight.
Yes, a little warm.
It is a little warm here,
yeah.
Isn't it? Peter, do you mind if I make a personal observation about you?
Oh, no. Go ahead.
Well, with your beard and the salty air about you, did anyone ever tell you you resembled Captain Ahab and Moby Dick?
No, sir. But by the way, I heard they made a movie of it, and Gregory Peck is playing it. It's very flattering. I'm very humble.
Well, I meant
thank
it
you.
That way.
Thank
I
you. Thank it. You. That's all right. That's fine.
Under the beard, I imagine you do look a little like Gregory Peck. You're both tall.
Well,
have you ever gone whale hunting, Peter?
Well, that's my trade. Sure, I have, yes.
Yeah.
But not like the Captain Ahab did. I'm just whaling up in Greenland. And we don't go for sperm whales there. We just go for white whales, blue whales, snare whales, and white whales, and the kind that's up there, you see.
Well, how do you go about hunting a whale?
Well, you see, the modern ways of whaling is to have a gun in the bow on the boat. But I'm going the old way, you know, using the hand harpoon.
Well, I was just about to ask you how you do it. You do it all...
Yes, with your hand, you have the line on this side, you know, and throw it out there and hit the whale.
What does the whale do?
He goes down to the button and stay there for an hour or two, if he can, and he's scared, you know.
I imagine he is a little scared, yeah.
Yes.
Well, does he ever come up?
Sure, he has to go up and get air again, and then he gets the second harpoon.
And you hit him again when he comes up.
Yes,
huh?
He's pretty sick, you know, when he's been down there for a long time. And then he gets the third harpoon, and we keep on until we get him.
You can keep him. You're entitled to it, after all. How many whales do you think you harpooned in your life?
Well, 20, 30. I don't count them, you know. We just cut them up and get the blubber.
Well, that's a lot of blubber, 30 whales. Well, Peter, let's get on with the game because I'm sure you're interested in winning a little money here. Last week, we ran out of time just after you answered the $512 question. Now it's time to step over to the area of Mr. Fike and answer the $1,000 question,
yes,
okay?
Fine.
Would you follow me, Peter, please?
You, yes.
In the category of seven C's, which covers many things, your question for $1,000. You ready for it?
Yes.
Here we go. This question is on maritime geography, Peter. For $1,000, what islands owned by the United States are the preserve and breeding ground for the largest herds of fur seals?
Well, that's the Pueblo Islands up at close to Alaska.
You're right. Just a fire at the told me they were in Wyoming. It wouldn't have made any difference. Your next question's worth $2,000. Do you feel like going for it?
Sure.
All right, Peter, here it is. $2,000 question deals with oceanography and wind flow.
Okay.
For $2,000, tell me first, in what direction does the upper current flow through the Strait of Gibraltar? Second, in what direction does the monsoon blow from April to October? First, in what direction does the upper current flow through the Strait of Gibraltar?
The upper current from blue flow to the east from Atlantic Sea in the middle.
That's correct.
Middle
second,
there.
In what direction does the monsoon blow from April to October?
From April to October, it blows from southwest to northeast.
That's correct for $2,000. With each question, Peter's getting a little wider smile. Your next question's worth $4,000.
Fine, go on.
All right, $4,000. Sorry, it takes a little time to get them out of the envelope. All right, $4,000. Your question is on exploring. For $4,000, tell me these three things. First, what Portuguese navigator discovered the sea route to India and later died while Viceroy of India at Cochin? Next, well, let's take that if you want to answer that.
Well, that was Fernando... Vasco da Gama.
That's correct.
That's the name. Died 1521.
That's not necessary.
Oh,
I didn't even know he was sick, to be honest with you. The next part of this question. What American sea captain first sighted Antarctica?
Oh, that was Captain Palmer from Stonington.
That's correct. Third, for $4,000, what is the full name and nationality of the man for whom the Barents Sea is named? That's B-A-R-E-N-T-S-C.
That was the Dutch Captain Willem Barents.
That's right, for $4,000.
Complete the next proceeding.
Okay,
well, that's all right. Fine.
You just picked up $4,000. You're having a lot of fun? Peter,
sure,
thanks for being
sure.
with us. We'll see you next week, okay?
Thank
Good night, Peter.
Night.
You know, ladies, no matter how often you use a greasy cream or scrub your face with soap, if you'll forgive my saying this, you still leave some dirt behind. So I'd suggest getting your skin thoroughly clean with
Clean and Clear.
We interrupt our program to bring you this important message.
You're listening to Carousel Sniper Victim, a Dead Glass Design production, with your host, Sean Jeffrey.
Peter Freuchen. He's probably one of the most badass dudes in history. His autobiography, entitled Vagrant Viking, My Life and Adventures, is dedicated thusly: to the memory of my mother, one of a long line of seafarers who taught me at an early age that staying at home is no way to get on in the world. What a sweetheart, dedicating his book to his mother. But you may have seen Peter Freuchen depicted on the internet, often accompanied by such headlines as, quote, the most badass man in history. He's often depicted wearing the skin of a polar bear that he supposedly killed in single-handed combat using only a knife. But some people say that the polar bear just saw Peter Freuchen approaching and decided it would be less painful to just skin himself and present Peter with his pelt. That is the sort of fucking dude we're talking about when it comes to Peter Freuchen. The largest of land-based carnivores, polar bears, more than likely trembled at the sight of this 6-foot-7 tall tower of exploratory human will. Nazi death squads, frostbite, avalanches, polar bears, wolves, Spanish flu, the inevitable march of industrial progress, TV game shows, and maybe the most terrifying force of all, Hollywood. Peter Freuchen took it all in his stride, and did whatever the fuck he wanted to do when he wanted to do it. And in doing so, he was probably one of the most influential explorers of the early 20th century. This is just some of his story. Lorenz Peter Elfred Freuchen was born in 1886 in the town of Nykøbing Falster in Denmark. He was the son of a well-to-do businessman. He was born at a time in the world's history when the inevitable march of progress was having a real impact on remote regions of the world, the so-called Great Age of Exploration. The Americans had established an air base on the Inuit lands of Thule, and although the Americans had done everything in their power not to ruin life for the Inuit people, it was inevitable. The march of industrial progress, The only thing that is constant is that everything changes. The American soldiers tried their best not to interfere with the locals. They were not allowed outside a determined area which had been agreed upon by the Danish government. The principle was good in thought, but the Inuit asked, and with good reason, what right do the Danes have to make such a demand? It's their land after all, but the Inuit are used to being ignored. A harbour the likes of which had never been seen in Greenland had to be built for the large freighters coming up north. A pier was built extending all the way into deep water. Day and night, trucks carried stone and gravel from the mountains to the waterside. Every third minute, a truckload of 30 tons was emptied into the water. Bulldozers and excavators did their jobs until a modern industrial harbour was made ready. This was now no place for seal and walrus to live. When Peter Frauschen first came to Thule in 1910, a man could be killed over a straight piece of wood. Wood the length of a man's arm could make a good spear, and as such was invaluable. People fought and died for such a commodity. Nowadays, pieces of wood of such description wash up on the shores daily, merely considered rubbish by modern values. How the times do change. Things are not the same as they used to be, Peter. Do you remember the house you built in Thule? The first house ever built there. This is a quote from Odak, an Inuit hunter and lifelong friend of Peter Frauschen. Peter was a pretty rambunctious youth, always exploring, always cussing out his elders and telling them to, you know, fuck off. He was a child of the northern wilderness, meant to explore and see the world, not meant to be confined to the walls of schoolhouses and lecture halls. As a youth, Peter always enjoyed the outdoors, sailing, hunting, climbing, testing his own theories and limitations on everything and anything he encountered. He was also a bit of a troublemaker. One time he disconnected the brakes of a railway freight car, just to see how far the momentum would carry it down the hill. The answer was all the way into the harbour and onto the pier before smashing into 1,000 pieces when it impacted a safety barrier. Luckily, not killing anyone. And school, well, school was boring. It wasn't for Peter. Not that he wasn't intelligent. Far from it. He just had far too much curiosity to be confined to some schoolroom all day. Quote, "Once we locked up a rooster in the teacher's desk. When he opened it to get his papers out, the bird flew straight into his face. The teacher ran to the headmaster's office, which gave us just enough time to throw the poor bird out the window and close the window again. When the headmaster arrived, there was no rooster, and no one in the class had seen anything." End quote. Formal education, it seems, was just always of a secondary nature and interest when it was compared with all the fun the real world could offer. There was experiences you could gain from exploring the outdoors that schools just couldn't provide. When Peter was old enough, he went to medical school at the University of Copenhagen, but again, soon realised that it wasn't the life for him either. He sought adventure. The first victims of his badass nature were the instructors at school. He gave them a lot of shit. Knowing that his place was out in the world, he quit medical school and joined up with an Arctic expedition. My most ambitious dreams were realized. 20 years old, I was going to spend a winter in the Arctic. It did not dawn on me that this was just the beginning. I felt as though my life had reached its climax. This expedition's goal was charting and exploring the winter wilderness. He signed on with an expedition in 1906 at the ripe young age of 20 with his buddy Nud Rasmussen. The two of them sailed as far as they could north, and then travelled over 600 miles across the barren wasteland, just to see what was out there. They started a relationship with the Inuit, learned the language, and went on epic hunting expeditions where they took on walruses, whales, wolves, seals, polar bears, and other insane things. And these newly found friends, the native Inuit, would surely become a huge part of Peter's life. Their collective knowledge and lifelong experience gained living in the frigid north would prove to be most valuable in the coming years, because, as we'll soon hear, Arctic exploration, it doesn't always go to plan. One morning I saw the first faint outline of purple on the horizon to the south, and I knew that the sun would soon be back. After 4 months of darkness and isolation, I was ready to return to base. Captain Trollet turned up on his sledge one morning to replace me, but he brought me tragic news. Mylius Erikson and his two companions had been missing for so long on their mapping expedition to the north that a rescue expedition had been sent out to search for them. The search had ended with the finding of the diary and the dead body of Jorgen Brundlund. Trollet told me the details of the fate of the three men, how they had been defeated in their last struggle. On their way north, they had met an unexpected deep fjord. It took them so long to cross the ice-covered water that they were delayed in the accomplishment of their main objective, to find out whether there really was a Peary Channel running between Greenland and further north. Erikson wanted to reach his goal, and they continued, hoping that just this once the ice would last a week or two longer. It did not. The ice went out, and with it, all hope of their return until fall. The three men had to depend on hunting for food for themselves and the dogs, and game was scarce. They suffered agonies before they died, fighting all summer against the weather and starvation. The first man died on November 15th, Mylius Erikson 10 days later, and finally, Brundlund. He had managed to struggle through to one of the emergency food depots 10 miles in the distance, but he was too weak to open the food cache and died beside plenty of food and fuel. The story made a deep impression on me, and I did not sleep much that night in my cabin. We had all grown very fond of Erikson. We knew his faults, but his shortcomings had not hurt his great popularity. If he had had the sense of order and organization of his second in command, he would have survived. But Erikson was of another caliber. He paid with his life for the honor of having carried through the Denmark expedition, and his name will always live in the history of the exploration of Greenland. With Erikson's death, we gave up our plans to cross the inland ice with sleds to the west coast. I'd looked forward to it as the highlight of the whole expedition. Instead, some of us made shorter excursions inland. And my first trip across the huge glaciers might have put an early end to my career. As we walked across the ice, we met occasional crevasses. Suddenly, the surface below me gave way and I started falling through the air. After some eternal seconds, I stopped falling. My right leg was against one wall of the crevasse and my back was against the other. I did not dare make the slightest move for fear I would fall into the bottomless pit below. At last I heard my companions calling me and I peered up at them. Far above, I could see the small hole I had made in the ice as I'd crashed through. My friends were cutting through the ice around the hole to find the actual edge of the crevasse. When at last they caught sight of me, they called out something unintelligible and disappeared. Had they given me up? Had they left me to die in the ice? I was in a panic. At last they reappeared with a long rope which they slowly let down the ice wall. But when it finally reached me, I feared to make a move. Then, with infinite care, I caught the rope, pulled it twice around my body and made it secure. In a moment, I was suspended in the air and carefully hauled to safety. I had to lie down for a moment when I was on top again, just to look at the beauty of the sun and the sky. In the most casual way, Cock walked over and asked if I was hurt, and then if I'd noticed any blue veins in the ice down there. The following days, I stepped through the ice several times without mishap, and it did not worry me. But in later years, I've had nightmares of falling down such crevasses, and I have never lost the conviction that my grave will be in one day. Every time I return to Greenland, I tell myself that it does not have to be this time, and I've been lucky so far. For days we explored the glaciers, collected plants and insects, and we discovered some high-grade coal deposits, but too far from the ocean or any navigable harbour to be of any use. On the return trip, we ran out of food and there was no game in sight. For 3 days we had almost nothing to eat. Finally, we reached a small depot that Captain Trolley had set up for us. We found the food, but Trolley had placed atop it a small petroleum drum. It had leaked. Coffee, tea, bread, everything was soaked through. Starved as we were, we couldn't eat any of it. And so we continued on to our base, where our cook, in the foggy afternoon dusk, mistook us for bears and tried to shoot us. A few weeks later, we made ready to break camp. And one summer day, in 1908, our expedition ended. It was not a happy day for me. I hated to leave Greenland and to exchange that free and wonderful life for my old job. I swore it was the last time I would accept such a job. One promise I have kept. By 1910, Freuchen had done some other expeditions in far-off regions, but the Arctic had his heart. So he returned to Greenland and started the trading post. He named the town around it Thule. Quote, "I suggested Thule from the expression Ultima Thule, which means, of course, north of everywhere and everybody." End quote. At the time, the average temperature was negative 12. Back in those days, they only wore fur, wool, and leather to keep them warm. In his book, he mentions that he would burn coal in his cabin, and the condensation from his breath would collect and freeze on the interior walls, and eventually he wouldn't have enough room to stand up. He spent a decade living among the Inuit, and became the first expert on them and their culture. Here he would meet and marry his first wife, Navarana, an Inuit woman, and have two kids with her that would bear some epic names. I'm not even going to try and say them. They have like, not even 15 letters, they probably have like 15 syllables in each name. Frauschen's plan to settle in Thule had some major lasting repercussions, including having one of his grandchildren become the first person of Inuit descent to be elected to the Canadian Parliament, and in a roundabout way it was responsible for the establishment of Thule as a United States Air Force base. But in the meantime though, Thule served as the home base for several expeditions between 1912 and 1933. The first Thule expedition in 1912 involved crossing 1,000 kilometres across Greenland to prove to contemporary cartographers that the North Pole and Greenland weren't just separated by a river. Both Freuchen and Rasmussen almost died on the trip, but ultimately, both just became even bigger bearded legends. Tragically though, Freuchen's wife, Navarana, contracted Spanish flu in 1921. I was left with two motherless children, and without foundation for the life I'd planned for my family. My future was going to be the life of the Eskimo, the most innocent, the happiest people I had ever known. My wife and my children were Eskimo, and I was going to be one of them. But how could I manage without Navarana? She had understood me. She had helped me and explained things to me. She could not be replaced by any other Eskimo or any Danish woman. My friends in Upper Nivik were a great help to me. They settled all the practical details while I was lost in my grief and confusion. But I had to report the death of Navarana to the minister and make the arrangements for her funeral. The man told me piously that since Navarana had died a pagan, she could not be buried in Christian soil. The bells of his church could not toll at her funeral, and he could not deliver a sermon or give her a Christian burial. I could hardly believe my ears, and at first I was so angry I could not utter a word. When I was able to speak, I told him I did not care a hoot about bells or sermons, but I would not have my wife buried outside the churchyard where her grave might be desecrated. If he tried to keep me from burying her wherever I wanted, he would have to take the consequences himself. And I picked my own spot without any further protest from him. Navarana was put to rest on top of the cliff overlooking the colony. I got the assistance of the post manager to help me collect stones and build a small mausoleum on the cliff. Navarana had to be buried without the benefit of the church and none of the Eskimos dared to follow her to her grave. They had begged of her favours while she was alive. She had helped them. She had given them of her plenty and her love, but now they did not dare show her the last honour. I had to pay the workers in the colony to act as pallbearers. I remember I was enraged because the blacksmith was smoking a cigar while he carried the coffin. He probably did it to demonstrate that he was only working and not voluntarily taking part in the funeral of a pagan. The funeral procession consisted of three of my friends in the colony and the young daughter of one of them. The post manager's housekeeper had made a wreath for Navarana, the only one. It was made of Christmas tree decorations. I noticed the red paper balls and the tinsel stars against the synthetic evergreen. It was a weird sight, but I was grateful for this one single tribute to Navarana, my wife. But even this tragic blow didn't hamper his spirit to get shit done. Freuchen then travelled around for a bit, did some safaris in South Africa and went to Siberia, wrote several books about living in the Arctic, killing animals and some ocean stories, as well as some fiction. Over 30 books later, he would marry his second wife, Magdalene Vang Lorenzen, daughter of Johannes Peter Lorenzen, Danish businessman and director of Denmark's National Bank. The marriage started in 1924 and ended in 1944. However, only 1 year into the marriage, in 1925, the family made Freuchen the editor-in-chief of a new magazine, a magazine that is still in circulation today and is the longest-running magazine in Danish history. He wasn't about to retire into his wealthy life, though. Not at all. In fact, he had his own private island in the north, as well as his house in Denmark, and he'd travel back and forth, as well as go back up to Greenland. Perhaps his most badass story took place in 1926, when he was still in the northernmost reaches of Greenland. There, he got caught in a hectic storm. Soon I could no longer see our tracks, but I managed to stick to the right course until I found the pile that we had left behind. I got the whole load onto my sled, and although it was heavy, I thought the dogs would get new strength when we turned around, and they knew that their food and rest was ahead of them. but the wind was straight ahead and growing stronger by the minute. Soon it was so violent my whip could not reach the dogs. I tried running ahead of the sled to stay close to the dogs where I could whip some speed into them, but it was no good. I thought it would be easy to find my way back since I had only to follow my own tracks, but they were already obliterated by the whirling snow. I determined the direction of the wind, which is an unreliable indicator. Without knowing it, I got off course and soon the dogs knew that something was wrong. There were hills we had never climbed before, and several times we got stuck in the rocks. The moment we got stuck, the dogs simply settled down in the snow and refused to move again. I first had to get the sled loose and then struggle with the dogs, screaming and swearing at them and using my whip to get them up. When this had been repeated a few times, I finally lost all sense of direction. Suddenly, we came to an enormous boulder where there was a deep depression in the snow on the windward side. It was like a small cave giving shelter against the howling wind. The dogs dived into the hole, and I decided to spend the rest of the night there as well. I set about building an igloo, but for the first time in my life I found it impossible to cut through the snow. It had been packed solid by successive storms, and I gave it up as a hopeless task. But I made up my mind to stay awake and wait for daylight. At first I kept awake by walking back and forth in front of the boulder. When this got too boring, I tried the old trick of walking with my eyes closed. I walked 10 paces straight ahead, turned right 10 more paces, and another right turn, another 10 paces, and the same thing a fourth time before I opened my eyes to see how far I'd strayed from my starting point. But for once, this game proved too cold, too windy, and too uncomfortable. I felt an unbearable desire to lie down, and saw no reason why I should not do so without risk, and I decided to make a small cave-like shelter where I could stretch out. I began digging in the solid snow, and soon I had a depression long enough for me to lie down in. I put my sled on top of this strange bed. Then I put all the lumps on top of the sled and around the sides. I had built my bed in such a way that the end opened up into the cave where the dogs were asleep, and I left this side uncovered, since it was well protected by the large boulder. On my sled I had the skin of a bear's head I had killed some days before, and I took this along for a pillow. Finally, as I crawled into my snug little shelter, I pulled my small sealskin bag in place with my foot so that it covered the opening like a door. When I did finally wake up, I was now very cold. I knew I had to get out and move about at once and get some circulation flowing. What worried me most was that my feet didn't hurt anymore, a sure sign of danger. To get out, I simply had to crawl out through my little door, and I inched my way down towards the bag. I could not move it. I used all of my strength, but it was obvious that I could not get out the way that I'd come in. I was not worried because I expected to turn over the sled which covered me and get up that way, and I managed to turn over and lie on my stomach so that I could push up the sled with my back. There was not room enough to get up on my knees, but I pushed up with my back the best I could. The sled didn't move. At last, I was getting worried. My friends would soon begin to search for me, of course, but the question was whether I could survive until they found me. Perhaps I could dig my way out, but the snow surrounding me was now ice, and it was impossible to make the smallest dent in the surface with my gloved hands. I had left my snow knife outside on my sled with all of my other tools. I decided to try digging with my bare hands for a bit, but my hands would freeze. It would still be better to lose one hand than to lose my life. I pulled off my right glove and began scratching with my nails. I got off some tiny pieces of ice, but after a few minutes my fingers lost all feeling. It was impossible to keep them straight. My hand simply couldn't be used for digging, so I decided to let it thaw before it was too late. By now, I was really scared. I was buried alive, and so far all my efforts had failed. As I moved a little, I felt the pillow underneath my head, the skin of the bear's head. I got a new idea. By an endless moving with my head, I managed to get hold of the skin. It had one sharp, torn edge which I could use. I put it in my mouth and chewed on it until the edge was saturated with spit. A few minutes after I removed it from my mouth, the edge would be frozen stiff, and I could do a little digging with it before it got too soft. Over and over again, I put it back in my mouth, let the spit freeze, and dug a little bit more. And I made some progress. As I got the ice crumbs loose, they fell into my bed and worked their way under my fur jacket and down to my bare stomach. It was the most uncomfortable and cold, but I had no choice but to keep digging, spitting, freezing, and digging. My lips and tongue were soon a burning torture, but I kept on as long as I had any spit left, and I succeeded. Gradually, the hole grew larger, and at last I could see daylight. Disregarding the pain in my mouth and ignoring the growing piles of snow on my bare stomach, I continued frantically to enlarge the hole. In my hurry to get out and save my frozen legs, I got careless. I misjudged the size of the hole through which I thought I could get out. My hand had naturally been able to move only above my chest and stomach, and to get my head in the right position seemed impossible. But I suddenly made the right movement and got my head into the right position. I pushed with all my strength, but the hole was much too small. I got out far enough to expose my face to the drifting snow. My long beard was moist from my breathing and from the spit which had drooled from my bearskin. The moment my face got through the hole, my beard came in contact with the runners of my sled and instantly froze to them. I was now trapped again. The hole was too small to let me get through. My beard would not let me get back and retire into my grave again. I could see no way out. But what a way to die. My body twisted in an unnatural position, my beard frozen to the sled above and the storm bearing down on my face without mercy. My eyes and nose were soon filled with snow and I had no way of getting my hands out to wipe my face. The intense cold was penetrating my head. My face was beginning to freeze and would soon lose all feeling. With all of my strength, I pulled my head back. At first the beard would not come free, but I went on pulling and my whiskers and some of my skin were torn off, and finally I got loose. I withdrew back into my hole and stretched out once more. For a moment I was insanely grateful to be back in my grave, away from the cold and the torturous position I'd been stuck in. But after a few seconds I was ready to laugh at my own stupidity. I was even worse off than before. While I had moved about, more snow had made its way into the hole, and now I could hardly move. The bearskin had settled under my back where I could not possibly get at it. I gave up once more and let the hours pass without making another move. But I did recover some of my strength while I rested, and my morale improved. I mean, I was still alive after all. I had not eaten for hours, but my digestion felt all right. Digestion. I got a new idea. I had often seen the dog's dung in the sled track and had noticed that it would freeze as solid as a rock. Would not the cold have the same effect on human discharge? Repulsive as the thought was, I decided to try the experiment. I moved my bowels, and from the excrement, I managed to fashion a chisel-like instrument which I left to freeze. This time, I was patient. I did not want to risk breaking my new tool by using it too soon. While I waited, the hole I had made filled up with fresh snow. It was soft and easy to remove, but I had to pull it down into my grave, which was slowly filling up. At last I decided to try my chisel, and it worked. Very gently and very slowly, I worked at the hole. As I dug, I could feel the blood trickling down my face from the scars where the beard had been torn away. Finally, I thought the hole was large enough. But if it was still too small, then that would be the end. I wiggled my way into the hole once more. I got my head out, and I finally squeezed out my right arm. And then I was stuck again. My fucking chest was too large. The heavy sled weighing more than 200 pounds, was on the snow above my chest. Normally I could have pushed it and turned it over, but now I had not the strength enough to do so. I exhaled all the air in my lungs to make my chest as small as possible, and I moved another inch ahead. If my lungs could move the sled, I was safe. And I filled my lungs. I sucked up air. I expanded my chest to its absolute limit, and it worked. The air did the trick. Miraculously, the sled moved a fraction of an inch. Once it was moved from its frozen position, it would only be a question of time before I could get out. I continued using my own ribs as levers until I had both arms free and was able to crawl out. I could only crawl, but I got my knife from the sled, pulled the dogs out of their cave and cut them loose from the harness. I planned to hold onto the reins and let the dogs pull me on the snow, but they did not understand. I used the whip with what little strength I had left, and suddenly they set off so fast my weak hands could not hold the reins. The dogs did not go far, but they managed to keep just out of reach as I crawled after them. I crawled for 3 hours before I reached the camp. Fortunately, I then did not know. The ordeal was to cost me my foot. So Peter Frauschen survived his own entombment in a self-made grave by digging his way out with a piece of frozen shit that he fashioned into a shank or a little poo chisel. What a MacGyver, yo. Well, it seems Hollywood was paying attention. In 1933, one of his books was turned into the film Eskimo. It told the tale of a fictional Inuit warrior's adventures in the Arctic. Frauschen helped write the screenplay, translate the dialogue into Inuit, was an interpreter on set, helped the film's crew survive, and played the film's villain, the captain. The film ended up winning an Oscar for Best Editing. At the premiere of the film, Peter Frauschen encountered a Nazi film director, a lady by the name of Leni Riefenstahl. She was Hitler's personal filmmaker. So what did Peter Frauschen do? He picked her up and spun her over his head. Laughing his ass off the whole time, he twirled her around in circles. He despised the Nazi ideologies. She apparently hated it. Frauschen then went on to start the Adventurers Club in Denmark in 1938, where dudes would sit around and tell epic stories in wood-paneled rooms with, you know, an epic fireplace and mounted animal heads. All that bullshit high socialite attitude stuff that people did back then. Around that time, the Nazis started influencing the countries of Europe, but he wasn't having any of it. Anytime an anti-Semitic comment was made, he'd either toss the guy around or just stand up to his full 6'7" height and tell the guy he was Jewish. What are you going to do about it? Even though he wasn't, he just didn't really give a shit. Shortly after that, he joined the Danish resistance, helping refugees, subverting Nazi operations, and was just so generally annoying that he was personally put on a kill list, and he was captured and imprisoned. However, he escaped and moved to Sweden, where he continued being a thorn in the Nazis' side, because nature couldn't kill this guy. What makes the Nazis think they could? Although, nature would come pretty close to killing him several more times. Whilst aboard the transport ship, the Molotov, bound for the port of Archangel, having now survived Nazis and the Arctic and Hollywood, he came very close to meeting his maker again. When we were close to the barge, we let down the ship's ladder and a few Jacob's ladders. The people rushed to grab them, and again some people fell overboard. There was no panic. They just did not know what to do. They had never been at sea before. The whole crowd on the barge consisted of lumbermen and carpenters, people with their families who had been chosen to go to Nordvik for the construction work. Three of us from the Molotov finally were lowered down by the ropes to the deck of the barge. Otherwise, we would have had no chance of saving anybody. I forgot that I was no longer 20 years old and had a wooden leg. While I was trying to keep my balance on the icy deck of the barge, I saw a sight I shall never forget. A young man was waiting to get hold of the Jacob's ladder, hanging down the side of the Molotov. The steamer was rolling heavily and the barge was pitching up and down in the waves. The only way to get up, of course, was to grab the ladder while the barge was on the crest of a wave and climb up as fast as possible. The young man did not understand the method. He grabbed the ladder while the barge was way down and crawled slowly up the ship's side. He had climbed only a step or two when, to my horror, I saw the barge lifted up and tossed against the side of the Molotov, catching the young man in the middle. His chest, arms and head were above the deck of the barge. The lower part of his body was caught below. I was close by him, and I could have sworn that he was laughing as I saw his mouth stretch in a wide grin. The wave receded. The barge sank once more, and we stared at the monstrous sight. He was still clinging to the ladder, but the lower part of the body was not there. The barge had cut him in two. Slowly his hands slipped from the ladder and the upper half of his body disappeared into the sea. We continued the rescue work at frantic speed. Most of the people were disciplined and knew enough to jump for the ladder at the right moment. An old woman who did not have the strength to climb the ladder got a rope around her middle and was hauled on board like a squealing pig. The few that were left did not have the strength or the nerve to leave the cabin and had to be let out one by one. In 1945, now after the war and a year after his second marriage has ended, Peter Frauschen moved to New York City, and there he would marry fashion illustrator Dagmar Cohn, who worked for Vogue. They actually did a spread on the two in the magazine, and this is where the famous photo of him looking like a total mountain man came from. A coat made from a polar bear, he hand wrestled and killed. He also joined the New York Explorers Club, and shared his stories with the rest of the men there, wrote more books and decided to settle into middle age. He even did some work for the United Nations for a while until, quote, "Then one day I had to interrupt my work for the UN for an enterprise of a quite different scope, a beauty contest to elect Miss Universe," end quote. As he related in Vagrant Viking, he was friends with the royal families of Scandinavia and other countries, and his movie work in New York City and Hollywood brought him into the royalty of moving pictures and the political world of Washington, D.C. In 1956, he won $64,000 on the $64,000 question, an American TV quiz show, similar to today's Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? The subject he was an expert on was the Seven Seas. He was only the fifth person in history to win the whole show, answering every single question correctly. Peter Frauschen really was someone who had seen and lived most of what life had to offer someone willing to seek it out, in that day and age anyway. Frauschen and his wife Dagmar lived in New York City and maintained a second home in Noank, Connecticut. The preface of his last book, The Book of the Seven Seas, is dated August 30th, 1957. He died of a heart attack 3 days later at the Elmendorf Air Force Base in Anchorage, Alaska. After his death, his ashes were scattered on the famous table-shaped Mount Dundas outside of Thule. Odark and Kwasavuk had seen me come to Thule as a young man. They had seen me marry, had seen my wife, Navarana, bear my children. We had all been tossed by the winds of fate. Navarana, my wife, had found her grave in Greenland. My children were far away. They had grown up in Thule. There they had waited while Navarana and I were gone, sometimes for days, sometimes for months. But we always returned to Thule. That was my home, and it always will be, even if the people move. The winds blow, the world moves on. It rolls over 300 Eskimos, their tents and their igloos. They do not complain. We go farther north, says Odark. New men have moved in. They know not the old ways. They have little peace or dignity. They have taken the land, but our land is great. We move on. And we know that you are a wise man, Peter. One day you will see that there is less happiness in the land of the white men. We are happy because you came to us, Peter. And we are happy because one day you will come back. Yes, life is a journey, as my friend Odark told me. We are being punished because we have stayed too long in one place, Peter. Life is a journey. The journey without end. Peter Frauschen didn't wait for life to deliver adventure. He sought it out, frozen poo knife in hand, ready to fuck up anyone and anything that stood in his way. Polar bears, wolves, Nazis, the frozen north, fuck them all. Oh, you want to know what's out there beyond where anyone else has ever been? Easy. Peter Frauschen.
It's what you hearing, listen. X go give it to you. Fuck wait for you to get it on your own. X go deliver to you. Knock knock, open up the door, it's real. With the non-stop pop out, I'm stainless steel. Go hard getting busy with it. But I got such a good heart that I make the motherfucker wonder if you did it. Damn right, and I do it again. Cause yeah. I am life, so I got to win. Break bread with the enemy. No matter how many cats I break bread with, I break who you send to me. You motherfuckers never wanna know you, but your life saved. Bitch, and that's on a life day. I'm getting down like a nigga said freeze. I won't be the one ending up on his knees, bitch, please. If the only thing you can't steal was came out to play, stay out my way, motherfucker. First we gonna rock, then we gonna roll, then we let it pop. Give it to ya, he gon' give it to ya. X gon' give it to ya, he gon' give it to ya. First we gonna rock, then we gonna fall. Then we let it pop, don't let it go. X gon' give it to ya, he gon' give it to ya. X gon' give it to ya, he gon' give it to ya. He ain't never gave nothing to me. But every time I turn around, cats got their hands out, won some from it. I ain't got it, so you can't get it. Let's leave it at that, cause I ain't with it. Hit it with full strength. I'm a jail nigga, so I face the world like a girl in the bullpen. You against me, me against you. Whatever, whenever, nigga, fuck you gon' do. I'm a wolf in sheep clothing. Only nigga that you know who can chill. Come back and get the streets open. I've been doing this for 19 years. Niggas wanna fight me, fight these tears. I put in work and it's all for the kids. But these cats done forgot what work is. They don't know who we be looking. But they don't know who they see, nigga. First we gonna rock, then we gonna fall. Then we let it pop. X gon' give it to ya, he gon' give it to ya. X gon' give it to ya, he gon' give it to ya. First we gonna rock, then we gonna fall. Then we let it pop, don't let it go. Come on. X gon' give it to ya, he gon' give it to ya. X gon' give it to ya, he gon' give it to ya. Ayo, where my niggas at? I know I got them down in the greens. Give them love and they give it back. Talk too much for too long.